Hello, everyone. Welcome to the series of our sessions on in challenging circumstances with Chris Sowton by Cambridge University Press, Cambridge Assessment English, with the support of the Linguist Company. Welcome to our series, and we are very glad that we have this nice tradition of meeting with our teachers each Friday and trying to support you during this challenging circumstances and challenging times for Ukraine. My name is Darina Siruk. I'm a senior business development manager for Ukraine and Caucasus, Cambridge Assessment English, and I'm very pleased to have my colleague with me, Tanya.
Hello, my name is Tatiana Shalepko. I'm a Cambridge University Press ELT consultant for the Linguist Company in Ukraine. And yeah, as Darina said, it's really a nice thing that we are having these sessions traditionally on Fridays, like some little anchors for teachers, which is really important these days. And it is important to develop professionally, and since the new circumstances and so challenging circumstances invaded our lives, we need to adopt our skills and create new skills to teach, to keep teaching students, to keep our educational mission.
And I think this is exactly what our teachers are doing right now, being scattered all around Ukraine, hopefully in safe or reasonably safe places, and also continuing to teach and following their mission, even based outside of Ukraine, being displaced for the time being.
So true, yeah.
I'd like to remind that we have this webinar presented in Zoom for those that registered for the session. And you can also join us online with our Facebook streaming. So if you have the chance to, and if you want to invite your friends to watch us there, please share the link to Cambridge University Press ELT Ukraine webpage. This is where we are being streamed right now. And I guess it's time we invited presented our speakers today. The topic is really interesting, and we got a lot of questions initially when the teaching started, but we kept getting these questions on how to teach if you have very limited or no resources at all. What techniques would you recommend using? So this is exactly what we are talking today, jointly with Chris Sowton, the author of Teaching in English in Challenging Circumstances book, which we made available to everyone.
And
speaker today.
And I'm introducing Brian Lally, who is our guest of Chris Sowton. And that's a really, really nice thing that Chris is doing, inviting people who have direct experience in teaching under challenging circumstances. So Brian is a teacher, an educator, and a researcher, and a program manager with broad experience in teaching in different countries, like in Africa, and also in Syria, working with Syrian refugees. And he also holds his PhD in this topic. I forgot the title of the paper, but you can read it in the description of the event. That's it. Welcome, Brian and Chris.
Thank you very much, Tanya. Thank you, Dasha. And thank you for that introduction. And it's fantastic to see so many people here today from all across Ukraine looking at the chat box, all across the country. So Brian, welcome to the webinar today. So Brian and I have worked together in Lebanon with Syrian refugees, and Brian, that's where you are now, isn't it?
Yes, it is, and I'm struggling with my internet speed, so if I come and go, my apologies in advance. So good afternoon, Chris, and good afternoon, everybody on Zoom and everybody on Facebook.
And Brian, so you've worked extensively with Syrian refugees and also Palestinian refugees in Lebanon and elsewhere, but particularly in Lebanon. When we think about teaching without textbooks, now I imagine in the situation you're working in, this is a very common issue. What would you say are some of the key things that teachers can focus on? How can they still teach when they don't have textbooks, when they don't have printed resources to hand?
Yeah, a great question. I just want to tie that in with something that was already said today, that we're, you know, where teachers have no resources in the classroom. The first and most important thing to say is that there is no such thing as a classroom with no resources. In fact, those kids, or whoever you're teaching, has the single best resource that they could have, and that is, of course, the teacher. And everything kind of stems from there. So maybe you are now in circumstances where you haven't got a class set of textbooks. In fact, you may have zero textbooks. Maybe you don't have access to printed materials or a photocopier, but that does not mean that you are without resources. It means that you have to shift your thinking about what resources are. And I think it can also very much mean that you shift your thinking about what is actually going on in your lesson. So let's right at the start, move on from this idea that there are no resources. Sorry, Chris, go on.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, I think sometimes in all teaching situations, we can feel that if we're not teaching the textbook, if we're not following a curriculum, then students aren't learning. That's a sort of a mindset I think we often get into across the world, not just in, right, in challenging circumstances. So it's, as you say, it's changing that mindset. And especially in Ukraine at the moment, it's thinking about learning in a different way. It's measuring success in different ways,
right?
And I
absolutely
imagine,
so
yeah,
we're because of the circumstances, challenging and horrific though they in so many tragic cases often are, there's also an opportunity here, and the opportunity is not just to unleash our creativity, but our opportunity is to in some ways take advantage of the fact that perhaps the rules are now slightly different in terms of having to slavishly follow a curriculum, because the circumstances dictate that we're in that position. So I'm not trying to create a sort of Pollyanna situation here where, hey, of course it's all marvelous and we can make the best of a situation, but actually there is an opportunity to be had to really rethink about, well, what are we teaching and why are we teaching this? And then how do we go about doing that?
And when you're working with Syrian teachers and Palestinian teachers in Lebanon, what kind of things do you say to them? What kind of approaches can you use? What does a lesson look like when there are no textbooks? How does the shape, yeah, of a lesson look like?
Well, I'm going to give you a great example that I've seen literally this morning, and it's something that we've been doing quite a lot of work on. So we've now moved out of the horrendously cold period here in Lebanon, and the weather at the moment is perfect spring weather. So I've seen three different classes today outside, and I've seen two of those were English classes, and they were inventive, they were fun, they were using a lot of really, really interesting things going on in the target language, and they were doing it through very simply playing outdoor games. So the teacher I saw with the grade one class, so that's 5 and 6 year olds, they were looking at basic directions, so up, down, left, and right, and they were improvising around a game which I would have known in the UK as pirate ships. All you need is one person with one voice to run that game. It's great fun, but the whole thing is conducted in English. So this is a really good opportunity for learning through play. We can do that because there is an outside space and the weather is favorable. So there you've got teachers using not the resources, not panicking about the resources they haven't got, but actually using the environmental resources that they do have. And what they're doing there, I think, is super interesting because there's so much more going on than just English language learning. And maybe this is something that we're going to come back to at various points in this conversation. You've got kids playing, you've got kids collaborating, you've got kids that are forced to be part of teams. So there's a whole extra set of skills development that is happening here. which in any context is, of course, hugely valuable.
Absolutely.
There's an enhanced importance to that in context of displacement and in context where there's fragility and uncertainty. So there are psychosocial protections that come not as an add-on, but built into activities where you've got English, which is taught through play.
Absolutely. And I think we often forget the importance of play, especially with young students, and, you know, how it's in context of displacement, that it is a way for children to be children or to have some kind of normal childhood, but also seeing it very much as a positive learning strategy as well. You know, we talked before in previous webinars about things like doing, you know, obstacle courses, you know, but not real obstacle courses, invented obstacle courses where you have to give directions and pretend you're walking over something or you're going through something. And it's the children giving instructions to other children. So they are developing collaboration, creative thinking, critical thinking, flexibility, resilience, all of these really, really important transferable skills. And there's also the physical benefit, you know, they are releasing endorphins as they are doing this and playing and laughing and all of these sorts of things. And it's how school can actually be an agent of positive change in these situations and not just something to keep children occupied for a certain number of hours in the day.
Absolutely. Now, very often when I have conversations like this with teachers, immediately people respond with, yeah, that's a great idea, but. So we don't have a schoolyard. We don't have good weather. We don't have physical space to do this. To which my response has always been, so use what you do have. And some of the inventive, creative solutions that people come up with, even in classrooms, which are hugely overcrowded, are just phenomenally interesting. The Chris knows this, but for the rest of you, I'll bore you with this as well. When I'm in classrooms, I always try and take a note of how many children are in the physical space, just because I find that it often is just quite an interesting point of reference. The biggest class I ever saw taught was in a very, very rural, pretty much abandoned area in Malawi, where there was no resource other than a quarter of a piece of chalk on what used to be a green board. I stopped counting when I got to 263 children in that classroom, but the teacher was still having these children physically actively engaged in learning. And it was an English lesson, actually, that class in particular. So even with the kids tightly packed in, there is still room for movement. Even if it's something as simple as head, shoulders, knees and toes game, or assignment set, or a teacher says kind of game, that there are still opportunities for learning through play where the children are not just listening to English, but actually have the opportunity to speak and use English with each other. So we're building all these opportunities using what is available and creatively working around the challenges and barriers that we have.
Absolutely. And I would just say one thing we do have to sort of in periods of conflict is to divide what, you know, genuinely is a safe or unsafe area. So it may be in terms of going outside, obviously in some situations it may simply not be possible at the moment to do that in Ukraine. But as you say, Brian, sometimes there's a perception that it's not possible, and so it's for teachers in Ukraine to differentiate between those things, what is actually dangerous and we can't do, but then what is perceived as being challenging. There was just in the chat I saw that about some practical tips. What I'm actually going to do, I'm just going to share on the screen now, is something from my book Teaching in Challenging Circumstances, which is freely available through Cambridge University Press, and I think we're going to find out a bit more about that later with some links about how to do that. I hope you can all see that on the screen. I'm also just going to talk through it for some people who maybe can't see that on their screen, or they're going to listen in later on the as an audio on the podcast. So this is something called a learning walk. And as Brian is saying, it's about using the outside as effectively as possible. So there's one really interesting quotation here that Sir Jickling said, walking has been described as the most fundamental pedagogy known to humans. You know, it's the way that we learn really, really effectively. And this is just an example of a script of how we could imagine a teacher going with their students into nature. So for example, a teacher says, what is this called in English? A tree. Good, everyone say tree. And then teacher drills the word tree. So here we have some pronunciation work that can be done, just getting the students to reflect on the situation they're in. Then the teacher holds up three fingers like this and says, what's this? And then three. So again, we're differentiating between the pronunciation of tree and three. So we're using a stimulus in nature in order to learn a pronunciation point, the difference between t and th, and then they can practice that. Then the teacher says, okay, you have 1 minute to touch as many trees as you can. Every time you touch one, shout tree. So here we have a physical activity, the students moving about, running about, but they are also practicing the language. They are practicing the target language. And again, they think it's a game. You know, we are smuggling the learning in. The students think, oh, this is just a fun activity. Why aren't we doing school? But actually, they really are learning. And anytime we can conceal the learning, then that's really, really effective. Then how many did you touch? Students say 2, 5, 10, whatever it may be. We're giving them the opportunity to share their experiences, to validate their learning, to say that their learning is important. And then we move on to this for number four. What words can we use to describe a tree? Now we're going a bit deeper. We've started with the general and now we go to being a bit more specific. So children throw out brown, green. Then we get to student four. And they say the word for hard in their first language because they don't know the words. And again, to me, this is a really important point about learning in nature, is that it stimulates students to say, I want to know the word for this, whatever it may be. So this is something in our session with Scott Thornbury, you know, who was the inventor of the DogMe methodology. Learning is so effective when students want to know the word. They know it in their first language, they know it in Ukrainian, but they don't know it in English. And then we as the teacher, that's when we can give them that word and they practice that word then. And then we move on. Some trees are tall. That's right, they can be tall, but when they are young, they might be quite short. Now draw a tree in your book and label it. So what we're doing there, the students are using all of these different experiences that they've had, the touching, the listening, the speaking, the working together, and they are turning it into something else. If you don't know some of the words, ask a friend. If they don't know, ask me. We're giving them that responsibility to work together. They have to work with each other on this. You are the final kind of support, but you say, well, if ask your friends first, then ask me if you don't know it. And then we can link on to other aspects of learning. So we've done the language part, but then we might say, why are trees useful? What do we use them for? So then we can talk about things like science or geography or other subjects. So again, in this situation, when you're using English and the stimulation from nature in order to then talk about other subject areas as well. Now, obviously, we can do this in different situations. You can do this in urban areas as well. Of course, there are maybe safety issues with this, as we've discussed before. But essentially, anything that's out there can be a stimulus for learning. What we have to do as teachers is to have the confidence to go with that, to trust ourselves to do that, to say, this is a little bit chaotic. This is a little bit different, but this is what we're going to try and do. Brian, any sort of reflections on that activity and how you could see that working?
Yeah, plenty. And I also want to tie that in with a comment I was just reading in the chat there about older children or pre-adults. These methods apply to any age. I did a teacher training workshop last weekend, and we had 2 hours of playing games with the teachers. I think they were more engaged with that than the children that I've seen. Yeah. So don't hesitate because of what you think the kids might feel they're too cool for. Actually, the whole point of play, the whole point of explorative learning, which is exactly what a learning walk is, that is equally applicable in any age. It's a mistake to think that only four-year-olds are engaged in this process of asking 1,000 questions per minute, because actually we're all built like this. We're built as inquisitive beings. This idea, I really want to echo the phrase that Chris used there of smuggling the learning. I think that's a great way to kind of underpin so much of what we've already talked about today. So you've got self-driven inquiry learning because you're introducing stimulus material that then the children or the learners are trying to find out about. But I also want to highlight what Chris was saying there about using the children themselves as a first point of reference for example, on a vocab list. So if you're pointing out what is that thing that's next to the tree? And if you don't know it as a learner, well, ask your friend first. And there's a very powerful dynamic that's taking place there, which is not just about maximizing the efficiency of the teacher's time. This is also about agency and tapping into the children themselves as resources for learning. And if you are able to do this, to build a culture where it's okay to have a go, and it's okay that some of the kids have the answers and some of the kids don't, then you will unlock a really, really powerful mechanism for learning where you can practice your English, you can make your mistakes, you can have explorative, inquisitive, child or learner-driven learning, which is super, super powerful. And if you're doing this in a way which is smuggled through play or smuggled through what looks like a discussion of science, then all the better. The learning that's, I'm convinced about this, the learning that is most effective and most powerful is the learning that we don't even realize we're doing at the time.
Yeah. I completely agree with that. And I think going back to an earlier point you were saying, I think so much of this, especially when dealing with teenagers or with adults, is about the teacher's attitude. You have to sell it. If you go in there embarrassed, nervous, shy about doing it, then it may not work. And it's very easy that teachers do this. They do that, it doesn't work, and they say, it doesn't work with those students, I can't do that. And they then switch off and go back to doing it in the normal way. You've got to sell it. And I think, you know, one of the many hats that we wear as teachers is of an actor. You know, we have to act, even if we feel nervous about it, even if we should feel shy about it, we have to oversell it. We have to be that enthusiastic person, because if you don't buy into it, then your students definitely won't. But I completely agree with Brian. You know, it can work with teenagers. It can work with adults 100%. And it may be that you just start with it small. You know, you don't jump in and say, right now, everyone needs to act in this kind of, you know, really extravagant way. That's not going to work. You do it piece by piece. You develop the trust, you develop the relationship, and then you open it up. But it is about you as the teacher selling that, I think, that's really important.
And also, what I really like about that is that sometimes the safety net or the crutch that we have in the classroom is the textbook. And we kind of default to this as somehow it's the Bible of what we're doing. It's some kind of sacred text. If you are, for whatever reason, in a context where there are no resources, you have no choice but to be broken from the shackles of that form of thinking. But that also means that when you are thinking about your lessons, when you are either improvising or making your own resources, then you have to take ownership of that. So you can't kind of in a half-baked way say, okay, well, we've got to do this exercise or this activity because that's what's in the textbook or that's what's in the curriculum. You're actually kind of force ownership, and then hopefully do that overselling, if you like. Absolutely, Chris, as teachers, as educators, we are performers, and we are that for very good reason, because we know that that's how it's easier to connect with the children who are in our care. But that also allows you, it liberates you to step outside of yourself. And if you're playing a role, then it doesn't have to be you that's embarrassed because, you know, you're running around pretending to be a chicken in the classroom and guilty as charged. There's a fantastic activity, which is a song, and it doesn't matter. That's the beauty of music and singing with kids. They don't care if you're terrible at singing. In fact, it's funnier better. And it's better if you're not, because that liberates them to not have to worry about being very good at it. In exactly the same way as making mistakes as a teacher with your English, whether deliberately or otherwise, also liberates the children to then have to be empowered to make their own mistakes. So just on that, is a really, really great recommendation I have for you. It's a song about a penguin. It's called "Have You Ever Heard a Penguin?" or "Have You Ever Had a Penguin Come for Tea?" Google it. It's brilliant. It's about directions and left, right, but it's also about.
It feels like we need you to sing it, really, Brian. I mean, it feels like that's what it's building up to here.
Yeah, sorry. That looked like this was totally contrived. unfortunately, for its full effect, you have to be standing up because it ends up with the entire class waddling around like penguins, but actually thinking about directions, thinking about left and right, thinking about parts of the body. There's a lot which is going on, and it's super, super fun as long as it's properly driven by the teacher who's got the confidence to kind of let go. And my goodness, with children in contexts where there's no resources, they really need the adults in their lives to be able to do that.
Absolutely. I think you're going to have to think of something. We've had Tanya saying, "Let's sing" in the chat, Brian. So I think that we've still got a good half an hour left here. So I think maybe we can build up to that later.
I'm up for it.
Okay, great. I'm just going to actually just jump back to the book briefly, because I just wanted to pick up on something you were talking about there. About students, you know, again, not being what we say blank slates, because sometimes we can think that our students don't know anything, that they come with no sort of knowledge there. But I think, as you're saying, and you know, there's lots that they do know, there's lots that we can draw from students there. And this part of the book talks about that a little bit. And I'm just going to highlight this bit here. It says, however old a student is, they have life experience which they can use in the classroom. Teachers can draw on this experience to help teach language. For example, imagine that the L2 or the English reading text is about a journey. All students will have experienced a journey before, even if only a short one in their local areas, e.g. from home to school. Asking students to think about and share their experience of journeys that they have made can help them better understand a particular text. So it's, if there is a text or if there is a story we want to tell, draw on something that you know everyone in that room has got some experience of, something like a journey, you know, some kind of relationships with others, you know, clothing, parts of the body. Think of the things which are universal that can be discussed. And so if we think about it from a journey perspective, there's so much rich language we can have just from discussions like, you know, has anyone been on a journey before? Tell me about it. Where did you go? Who did you go with? What happened during the journey? How did you feel? What kind of language would you use to describe your journey? So then after that general introduction, you can then really turn it to the issues of language. You talk about the past simple or adjectives or sequence words, you know, so you can build in some real language and grammatical work from that. You don't need a text necessarily. Draw on the students' experiences and then make it sort of more specific as we go forward and more relevant to, you know, some kind of curriculum or some kind of language that we want them to acquire. There's been a couple of questions, I think, come in through the chat box. So I'm just going to go to a couple of those. Thank you for those questions. And please do keep on sharing those things there. So one from Natalia saying, are there any activities for children to be back into the topic of the lesson after an air alarm? So again, the reality of the situation, how can we calm students down? How can we bring them back into the room after something like that? Any thoughts there, Brian?
I think it's about trying to reestablish your routine as quickly as you can. And this also is about how teachers play a part. This is how teachers are actors and performers, because in those circumstances, you cannot switch off from the fact that you are also a human in that situation. And there, you're not a machine. So the fear and the uncertainty that goes with the with those sirens that the children are feeling, of course it's normal and right and to be expected that you're feeling that. But this is where you come in, not just as performers, but you could, but absolutely perform being confident if you need to, if that needs to be a performance. But this is where teachers are leaders. And this is where teachers are, in so many cases, unsung heroes. So sometimes this means that we have to lead the way in terms of how we regulate our own behavior. And that means very often returning to the routine and the expectations in the classroom as much as you can, okay? Because this is what children are looking to you to do. They're looking for reassurance, even though you might not have any reassurance it yourself, you still need to find some way to give them that. And keeping back to the purpose and keeping back to the routines as best as you can, it is absolutely the best way that you can provide that kind of resilience and stamina and reassurance that the children are looking for.
And some kind of just basic sort of transition activities that can ground the students again. So that might be as simple as breathing exercises. Exactly. That we just do just something after that sort of event. What we do is we just 5 breaths in, 5 breaths out, something as simple as that, or just the touching of your fingers, a breath on each finger, touch your next finger, in, out, in, just something as simple as that can be a way to say, you're back in the room, you're back in a safe space, because this is what we always do. This thing happens, and then what we do is we have this thing, and then we transition back into what we do. So sometimes just those sorts of grounding activities can be very, very effective.
I've seen some really good practice where teachers have their routines at the start of every lesson. So exactly, transition activities, whether it's transition from a break time into the start of a lesson or from one lesson to another, this is just reestablishing the normality of the renewed situation. So you're back in the classroom, circumstances have changed, but you're now transitioning back into the time of learning and you can resonate with your normal routines for reestablishing the start of a lesson. I'm conscious that both Chris and I have kind of spoken all about all of this really quite quickly, because these are really difficult situations to be in, and they are hugely human situations to be in. We're not machines and we're not robots. If you are feeling unsettled and frightened, well, there's probably very good reason for that. And it doesn't mean that you have to pretend completely not to be bothered by this, because that doesn't help anybody, including the children that's in front of you. But this is about saying, well, okay, well, we've been through this. This happened. This siren, this warning, whatever the situation was, happened. And now we're back to where we needed to be. So let's steady ourselves, exactly as Chris is saying, and let's return to what we were doing. Let's return to our focus.
And not to be afraid of things like, you know, circle time, you know, having the group, the class in a circle, which is such an empowering thing, just the shape of everyone being in a circle together with a sort of common purpose. And again, there's just grounding activities we can do there. You know, throw a ball to someone, and just say a word, just any kind of English word or whatever it may be. Again, something like that is a way of bringing it back to learning about English, but also bringing it back, we are a group, we are one, we are united, we are together. I just want to, there's another kind of point from Yelizaveta. She says, probably you can give some tips on how to minimize the usage of the native language by students, because you know, when we have an activity like ask something to your partner students, they tend to do it in their native language. I'm just going to say, Elizaveta, yes, the purpose of an English class is to learn English, but I would also say, don't put too much pressure on yourself during these times to do that. Coming back to this issue of feeling safe in the classroom, the L1 Ukrainian is a way that students can feel safe. So I would say don't push against that too hard. I know we want to learn things. I know we want to learn that target language. Sometimes something I recommend doing is, you know, because during these times, students may find it really difficult to do things which are linguistically hard and cognitively hard at the same time. So you might set them a task to say, okay, here is the task. Talk about this. You have 1 minute. Talk about it in Ukrainian. And they blah, 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 blah. Talk about it. Okay, stop. Now you have 1 minute. Do the same task again. Do it in half Ukrainian, half in English. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, that's fine. Now do it again. Now try and do it in as much English as you can. Get them familiar mm-hmm. with the content first. That will give them confidence. That will make them feel safe. Then we can go into the slightly riskier areas of doing it in English.
Yeah, and just to add to that, as an extra dimension to this, if you're talking specifically in the context of games, in order to encourage as much use of target language as possible, well, teams are your friend here. And especially if part of the role of being in a team is to monitor what the other teams are doing. So if you are creative, so for example, maybe you've got a very simple activity where one student is required to walk backwards at the direction of a second student. So they're saying, okay, take 3 steps backwards, take 1 step left, take 2 steps backwards. Something as very simple as that, you could easily have a third student from a third team as the monitor. Mm. But their job is not to catch them out. Their job is to catch them in. So, and there's a broader point here about praising the process. So what we're saying is we're not giving points for perfection of English, but we are giving points for trying. And we are encouraging through positively supporting the effort rather than necessarily the outcome. And there's a lot going on in terms of the psychology of that, but it's really powerful and really effective. It also gives children permission to default to native language if they need to, but also it's an encouragement, a positive encouragement for them to try and push themselves without feeling that if I get it wrong, somebody's going to catch me out. Okay, so we are creating the conditions where it's still fun and kids love checking each other. They love it.
Oh, yeah.
But also you're still doing this within the context of a game. So the overarching framing of all of this is fun.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lovely comment just come in here saying our children are the best ones because they keep concentrating on studying. It helps them to distract. I can say in any situation, they really stay strong and brave. In these circumstances, they are trying to stay positive. And I think that's absolutely right. It's it is that distraction. And that's, I think it's really important as well, coming back to the point you were saying, Brian, about how, you know, teachers are frontline workers in this situation, as much as I really would say, as much as soldiers, as much as firefighters, as much as medical professionals, because they are supporting and helping the next generation. But what they are also doing is providing a fantastic service to parents in Ukraine as well, because they are giving them the mental space to sort themselves out, to do the things that they need to do to help themselves as well. It's a huge burden and a huge responsibility, but teachers, you guys here listening today, are really supporting not just the children, but that whole generation and their parents as well. And I think that's a really, really important point to remember.
Absolutely. Can I pick up on a couple of things there, Chris? So firstly, this idea of the kids being strong and staying positive as much as they can, that's great. The slight caveat on that is, as long as they are also knowing that it's very okay, it's very acceptable not to be okay.
Yep.
It's very okay if they're not able to stay positive. And so we're not only kind of expecting the kids to behave or respond or feel something that they're not, or feel something artificial. The other thing I want to pick up from what Chris said is about the kind of broader impact or where education is currently fitting in, particularly in the context of the conflict. One thing that has so strongly come across from my conversations with the families, particularly of the Syrian refugees that I've been working with, often in hugely difficult circumstances, is how much the families value the very fact that education is happening. So they are, the existence of the education, the continuity of the learning, they're prioritizing over the quality. So what often goes out the window in these circumstances is the formal script. And it would be a mistake to get over anxious about that. And missing the broader point that the very fact of the continuity, the symbolism of that, the totemic power of the fact that learning is continuing in any shape or form is by a long, long way the most important thing about the education that's happening there. So give yourselves a break, right? If you feel like you're not somehow getting through the curriculum and in the same pace that you would have been in other circumstances, well, hello, of course, right? The fact that you are turning up for these kids and for their families and for your country really matters. The symbolism of this is hugely important.
100%, 100%. I'm just slightly aware of time. There's a couple of things I just wanted to bring it back slightly to our kind of main theme and some perhaps more sort of practical tips as well about what you can do if you are struggling with resources or you don't have those, say, textbooks, et cetera, et cetera. Here's just a couple of things again from my book we can see here. So one thing you can do is about using found objects as a resource. So for example, finding safe things to do, like might be paper leaves, plastic bottles, not glass or shrapnel or anything like that. Dividing the class into groups, and they can use their imagination to make something, you know, whatever that may be, a piece of art. It can be, you can give them something, make a mountain, make a truck, make a television. Again, what it is, then they're working together and they're using language that whole time to do that. You can also use the community as a resource, you know, and again, this can be a way of bridging some of those challenges. You know, it could be very empowering for parents to come in and talk about what they do, or just they can be a resource and students can ask them questions about whatever it may be. They can just be a language resource in themselves. Tell me about what you did when you were a child. Tell me about your work, whatever it may be. And now for some parents, they won't want to do that, but some who speak a bit of English, this might be a really nice opportunity for them to share with that with the class. Also, other resources that you can use, newspapers. Still, you know, most places you can still get newspapers and they're relatively expensive or free to use. They can be great stimuluses as well there. You can talk about the pictures that are there. You can act out the plays. If it's written in Ukrainian, you can translate them into English, all sorts of things. It's another really useful stimulus that you can use. Photographs as well, whether they're printed photographs or digital photographs, rich sources of information. Talk about the pictures, describe what's happening, talk about what happened before that picture, talk about what happens after that picture, or give a group 5 random photos and say, okay, here you go, make a story where all these 5 things happen. You have to include all those 5 pictures in your story. And then just the last one is real objects. Realia, we can sometimes use there. Get them to bring stuff in, do a show and tell. They talk about the objects. Or it may be that a student describes the object but doesn't show it, and the rest of the class have to draw it. And then the student reveals the object and talks about why it's important for them. Or you talk about the life history of an object. And that can be just really inventive. It doesn't have to be real. You talk about this pen. This is a 100-year-old pen. It was first found in, you know, America in the 1920s, whatever it may be. Make it up, be creative. The stimulus could be anything. What is so important is your attitude as the teacher to let students go with that. But anything can be a stimulus for language learning. It's dependent on you letting that happen, creating the framework for students to explore through the language. Brian, anything to share on that? Any reflections?
Yeah, I want to do this. So the one thing you missed was puppetry, isn't that right? Right. So all it takes is a sock or a glove on top of the hat, and you've got an instant resource. You've got an instant way to do dialogue, okay, without having to sing any song. But feel free to do that if you want to. It is about unleashing your creativity, and now, hopefully, in spite of all the horrendous challenges that the teachers themselves are facing, there's also perhaps an enhanced, I would suggest, motivation for doing this, but also enhanced reward for doing this. So this improvisation, this creativity, this is not just playing, this is not just for fun. This is dead serious. This is about learning, but this is also about protection and resilience through learning, through as close to continuity with previous education as possible. But as well as the responsibility and the challenge, it's also the privilege of being a teacher in these contexts. And especially at times, and this is absolutely the story of the communities that I'm working in at the moment here in Lebanon. We have the real gift as well as the responsibility and as well as the challenge, but very much the gift of working with young people. And when you're working with young people, you are by default talking about the future. And when you're having conversations about learning with your colleagues or with the children's parents, you are immediately displacing their focus from the present. And when your present is particularly horrific and is particularly difficult, then that's an incredibly useful thing to be able to do. So every second that you're at work, you're investing in a future. So your focus is about something which is better tomorrow. Now, that delivers not just for the children in front of you, and goodness knows it absolutely does, but also that's about your future and about your community's future. So what you're doing is hugely difficult, but more important now than it has ever been.
Absolutely. Thank you for talking about puppetry. That is also, it's a hugely valuable thing to do. And there's also a really added psychosocial value of that as well, because you can say to your students now, and this is to sort of students who may be facing issues of motivation and all those sorts of things, say, well, okay, I'm teaching you, but you're teaching your puppets. You are responsible for teaching your puppet English. So you might do something in a class, 5-10 minutes, say, okay, now you've got 2 minutes, teach your puppet. You know, so it's a way of recycling that information. It's a way of them receiving that, thinking about it, and then producing that. They can do that in Ukrainian, that's absolutely fine, or a mixture of Ukrainian and English. But what you're doing is you're giving them a responsibility, and you're saying to them, you can make a difference. You can impact on something else's life positively. And it may just be a sock on a hand. It might just be a, you know, silly bit of cardboard or whatever. But in a 9-year-old's mind, that is Bob, or that is Lucy, or whoever it may be. That's their character that they made. And it's hugely psychologically beneficial to students to be able to do that. And we can extend that even further by things like, you know, I've seen before where students have been given a plant each, you know, to look after within the class. And it doesn't have to be a nice fancy rose or anything like that. It can even be a weed, it can be something, but it's something that they are responsible for trying to keep alive, to try and maintain. Mm-hmm. And just having that can also improve the environmental aspect of the classroom as well. So even if there has been damage to the classroom and all those sorts of things, you can, in your little section, just what you see, you can see something positive. You can see a bit of green. You can see life. You can see something optimistic.
Right. And if I can chuck in some English language specific benefits from this as well. Of course, if you're working with puppets, then it's really easy to move the focus of your dialogues on from first and second person to third person. But also this unlocks so much potential for humor without causing offense. So of course, the sock is naughty, or the sock has bad, you know, has really bad taste in music or smells. Okay, you can insult the puppet.
Especially if it's one of Mr. Brian's socks that he's brought for the session.
Yeah, I mean, thank goodness we haven't got to that level of interactivity yet through the internet. but you see the point there. This is not just about having fun. This is about how we use minimal or zero resources to really think about how we are deepening and developing the actual learning, and in this case, the specific English language learning. So why next time you're in the classroom, why not think about how are we going to teach that grammar point through the power of the sock puppet? Why not?
Absolutely. And it's great to see in the comments. So Nana has said, it's my favorite part of a lesson when we don't use a book. And I think it's exactly that kind of attitude which is necessary to see it as an opportunity, you know, and of course, in a sense, you know, it's not an opportunity that you wanted, but it is an opportunity that is present. And it is an opportunity which can be accessed at this particular time. There's one more activity. I know we've only got a few minutes left. There's one more activity I just wanted to share with you that you could use. Again, it's using the outdoors more effectively for learning. It's called Listen to the World. You can see it on the screen now. So what we say is all the students get up and go outside. They take pencil and paper and they walk around wherever they like for 5 minutes. Again, obviously within the, you know, if it's safe to do so, then to do that. If it's not, then obviously don't. As they are walking, they should write down all the sounds that they hear. You know, for example, I heard a dog barking. They should do this in English if they can, or in Ukrainian. If not, then they come back to the class with this list of sounds, some in English, some in Ukrainian. And then they might discuss questions like, what was the sound you heard the most? What was the most interesting sound? What was the most unusual sound? And what sound is easiest to make with your own voice? Can you do it? So again, what we're getting them to do there is they are listening, they are speaking, they are sharing, but they are also having fun as well, trying to make those different sounds that are there. And all of this is free. It's just outside your classroom. So again, it's just looking at everything that's out there. I think this is, you know, if we're going to try and summarize some of the key points from today, it's just saying, well, what is in your local area? What resources are there that are safe to access for your students? And how can you get them to talk about those things? How can you link that to the learning that you are doing?
I really like the fact that you've given this as an example, Chris. I also want to link it to some of the early discussion that we had about that transitioning from perhaps alarm or context back in. So all those techniques of awareness and environmental grounding. Well, we know, for example, that this is the same territory, I'm not saying these are exactly the same techniques, but we're on similar territory to regrounding activities that people are encouraged to use if they're experiencing an anxiety episode, for example. So this is about not just getting into the routine because it's good for language, but that also might be a routine that is actually quite helpful for people in terms of transitioning from immediate kind of pressure points in terms of what might be alarming in terms of the broader context, to try and re-engage people with a more reassured, more stable return to learning.
Absolutely, and just the act sometimes of doing that, of going out in outside mm-hmm. and learning is an act of resistance as well. The fact that you are going out there, you are owning your own space, you are owning your own land, you are learning from that, is an act of resistance in its own way. So there is that positive dynamic as well that's going on there. Okay, I think we are coming to the end now, and I think Dasha and Tanya wanted to share a few bits and pieces with you, but Brian, anything that you'd just like to say to sort of summarize and bring things to a close, and a sort of a final message for our Ukrainian colleagues listening today?
Yeah, I mean, very simply, and also very much not simply, we are clearly in a time where huge amounts are being asked of you. But what the teachers that I've worked with have taught me is that they rise to those unbelievable challenges in the most phenomenal way. Embrace your creativity, but give yourself a break, right? Don't panic about the curriculum. Don't panic about the lack of resources. Trust the fact that you are the single best resource with all your creativity, all your energy, all your ideas. You are the best resource that these children could ever hope for. And that's, and you're all that they need.
Absolutely. Thank you, Brian. So Dasha, I can see you are emerging like a neon pink flash.
Yeah, that's how I masked myself to match the poster.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for the conversation, Chris and Brian. And I think that was not only very practical, but it was very inspirational. So we enjoyed listening to that a lot. What we would like to finish with is the list of the useful resources that we've compiled specifically for the teachers of Ukraine on a separate page for all of us. We'll share the link to the page in the chat and in the comments on Facebook page. So all of the resources that are available here are free for teachers to use. We've divided them into sections. So we have the first one for teachers. The second one is for parents and young learners. So you can recommend parents to work together with their kids if they have some knowledge of English. Then we have separate resources for teenagers, their parents, and adults. Some of the resources are even downloadable to the mobile devices, whichever your students have. We have separate exam boosters. It's like the workout or language workout for exam preparation. So we definitely recommend you checking that as well. And separate series of fun skills booklets. Probably Tanya will tell you more. She's an expert in Cambridge University Press materials.
Okay. Yeah, fun skills home booklets are available here to download, and you can find the information, like audio and media files for them on the Cambridge.org website as well. So all the all the necessary links are here. And also Quick Minds for Ukraine with video lessons and with all the necessary materials that you need, which are free now on flipping books, both pupils and activity book you can find here. And with the lessons, I just couldn't stop but find the Willy the Wolf. This was my friend since the times of COVID. So he will be there to help you, help your primary students at the video lessons. And also there is something we wanted to mention as well. This is the upcoming conference on, so save the date, the 21st of April.
That's Thursday.
Yes, Thursday. We will be having an international event supporting displaced learners and teachers from Ukraine together with Chris and Robinson. And I guess many teachers in Ukraine remember Anne Robinson as one of the authors of Quick Minds 4. Matt Ellman, especially those teachers who managed to see him live at our 1 week event 4 years ago, might remember him well. And Kate Brierton, who is a great expert in psychology and therapy, will be giving their talks. And yeah, so save the date. And if you want to register, go to our Facebook page. The link for registration is there.
Yeah, we've also shared that into the chat. So looking forward to welcoming you all there. That's an international event. So it's not only for teachers based in Ukraine at the moment, but we are also inviting teachers from the countries where Ukrainian teachers are now based temporarily so that they can learn more about the education system in Ukraine, how we teach our kids in Ukraine, and how to support them at the moment. Thank you very much all for taking your time. I know it's Friday before Easter, so thanks again, Chris and Brian, for taking your days off and spending it with Ukrainian teachers. It's really very much appreciated.
It's a great pleasure. And just to say, please do continue to use the CEP Ukraine Facebook page as well. If you've got any other questions, please, you can drop them in there. And I think Brian has agreed that we haven't got time for the penguin song, but he said he will record a video and upload that to the Facebook page there. So thanks for that, Brian.
Cool, thanks.
Why not? It's been a privilege to spend this time with you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you, really motivating. I feel so much more alive now after this session. Thanks a lot.
Good. Thanks a lot.